Hello everyone, now let us discuss about renin. Renin is the major determinant of rate of angiotensin II production. And the renin is synthesized, stored and secreted by exocytosis into the renal arterial circulation by granular juxtaglomerular cells, JD cells, located on the walls of efferent arterioles that enter the glomeruli. Renin is synthesized, stored and secreted by exocytosis through granular JD cells. And renin is an aspartyl protease that cleaves the bond between residues 10 and 11 at the amino terminus of angiotensinogen to generate angiotensin 1. And the active form of renin is a glycoprotein that contains 340 amino acids. It is synthesized as a pre-pro enzyme that is processed to prorenin. Coming to prorenin. Prorenin is as such it is inactive. It is activated either proteolytically or non-proteolytically. Proteolytically means enzymatically or non-enzymatically. Coming to proteolytic activation of prorenin by proconvertase 1 or cathepsin B enzymes, they remove the 43 amino acid propeptide from the amino terminus to uncover the active site of renin. Coming to the non-proteolytic activation of prorenin, the prorenin, it binds to prorenin receptor, resulting in conformational changes that unfold the propeptide and expose the active catalytic site of the enzyme. And both renin and prorenin are stored in JD cells. When released, they circulate in the blood, and the concentration of prorenin is 10 folds greater than the renin, and the T half of renin is 15 minutes. Here you can see, as such, this is prorenin. It is as such inactive, and this is the 43 amino acid propeptide which blocks the active catalytic site. And non-proteolytical activation is usually reversible. It occurs by binding of prorenin to prorenin receptor, which leads to conformational changes, and it unfolds the propeptide and exposes the active site of the renin. And proteolytically, it is done by removal of this 43 amino acid propeptide by enzymes such as proconvertase 1 or cathepsin B. And usually the proteolytic activation is irreversible, whereas non-proteolytic activation is reversible. One more important point is direct inhibition of renin by aliskiren. Aliskiren is a competitive renin inhibitor. Aliskiren has greater affinity for the binding site to the active catalytic site of renin than the angiotensinogen. Coming to the control of renin secretion. The control of renin is mainly governed by three pathways. The first one is macula densa pathway, the next one is intrarenal baroreceptor pathway, and the next is beta 1 adrenergic receptor pathway. Coming to the macula densa pathway. The macula densa pathway provides an important function for salt and water regulation by renin angiotensin system. The macula densa, it lies adjacent to the juxtaglomerular cells and is composed of specialized columnar epithelial cells in the wall of that portion of the cortical thick ascending limb that passes between the efferent and efferent arterioles of glomerulus. In simple words, the macula densa lies adjacent to JD cells. And the change in sodium chloride reabsorption by macula densa results in the transmission to the nearby JD cells of the chemical signals that modify the renin release. Any change in sodium chloride reabsorption by the macula densa, it sends the chemical signals to the adjacent JD cells, which modify the renin release. Here, increase in the sodium chloride efflux across the macula densa inhibits the renin release. Increase in sodium chloride flux across the macula densa inhibits the renin release, whereas decrease in the NaCl flux stimulates the renin release. Coming to the mediators which modulate the macula densa pathway, they are ATP, adenosine, prostaglandins and catecholamines. ATP and adenosine, they inhibit the renin release when sodium chloride transport is increased. Both ATP and adenosine, they inhibit the renin release when the sodium chloride transport increases. Whereas prostaglandins and catecholamines, in case of prostaglandins, especially PGE2 and PGI2, they stimulate renin release when sodium transport decreases. Additionally, the prostaglandins production is enhanced by COX-2 and nitric oxide synthase. And selective inhibition of these enzymes, that is COX-2 and NOS, inhibit the renin release. Now, one more important point is the regulation of macula densa pathway is more dependent on the luminal concentration of chloride ion than the sodium ion. The regulation is more dependent on the luminal concentration of sodium rather than the concentration of chloride rather than the sodium ion, because NaCl transport into macula densa is mediated by Na plus, K plus and 2Cl minus symporter, and half maximal concentrations of sodium and chloride required for transport via this symporter are 2 to 3 milliequivalents of sodium and 40 milliequivalents per liter of chloride are required for half maximal concentrations. And because the luminal concentrations of sodium is much greater than the level required for half maximum transport, physiological variations in the luminal sodium concentrations at the macula densa have little effect on the renin release, because the symporter will be saturated in respect to sodium ions. Conversely, physiological change in chloride concentrations at the macula densa in the range of 20 to 60 milliequivalents per liter can profoundly affect macula densa mediated renin release. So finally, the regulation of macula densa pathway is more dependent on the luminal concentration of chloride ions rather than the sodium ion, especially in macula densa. Now here you can see the mechanism. Usually, the sodium depletion upgrades. Whenever there is sodium depletion, it upgrades NOS and COX-2 in the macula densa to enhance the production of prostaglandins. These prostaglandins and catecholamines, they stimulate the adenyl cyclase AC. Both prostaglandins and catecholamines, they stimulate adenyl cyclase, and this leads to increased production of cyclic AMP, and finally which increases the renin release. So plus and green arrow indicates increase. Prostaglandins and catecholamines, they stimulate adenyl cyclase. This adenyl cyclase increases the cyclic AMP, and increased cyclic AMP leads to increased renin release. And next point is increased sodium transport depletes the ATP and increases the adenosine level. Increased sodium transport, it depletes the ATP and it increases the adenosine level. And this adenosine diffuses to the JD cell and inhibits the cyclic AMP production. Adenosine diffuses to the adjacent juxtaglomerular cell and it inhibits the adenyl cyclase and finally inhibits the cyclic AMP production via GI coupled AN. So this inhibits the renin release. Adenosine inhibits the renin release by inhibiting the production of cyclic AMP, and it is mediated by GI coupled adenosine A1 receptors. And increased sodium transport in macula densa, augments the efflux of ATP. The increased sodium transport from macula densa, it augments the efflux of ATP, and this ATP, ATP may inhibit the renin release by directly binding to P2Y receptors and activating the GQ, PLC, IP3 calcium pathway in the juxtaglomerular cells. And finally, even the circulating angiotensin 2, also inhibits renin release via GQ coupled AT1, angiotensin 1 receptors. This is the overall mechanism of renin. Coming to the next pathway, intrarenal baroreceptor pathway. So here, increase in BP or renal perfusion pressure inhibits the renin release. And similarly, decrease in BP or renal perfusion pressure, it stimulates the renin release. The main effect for stimulation, or the main stimuli for stimulating the release, is reduced tension in the wall of efferent arteriole. It stimulates the renin release. Now coming to next pathway, that is beta-1 adrenergic receptor pathway. The beta-1 adrenergic receptor pathway is regulated by release of norepinephrine from postganglionic sympathetic nerves. And the activation of beta-1 adrenergic receptors, it increases the cyclic AMP and enhances the renin release. So treatment of beta blockers, it reduces the renin release and plasma renin activity. Coming to the feedback regulation, renin is subjected to feedback regulation. The feedback regulation is of two types: short loop negative feedback regulation and long loop negative feedback regulation. First of all, coming to short loop negative feedback regulation, increased renin secretion enhances the formation of angiotensin 2, which stimulates the angiotensin 1 receptors on the JD cells. This inhibits the renin release. This is short loop negative feedback mechanism. Inhibition of renin release due to angiotensin 2 dependent increase in blood pressure, not directly by the increased angiotensin concentration, but the inhibition of renin release due to angiotensin 2 dependent increase in blood pressure via this is also mediated by angiotensin 1 receptors, but this occurs due to increase in the BP. So this is called as long loop negative feedback mechanism. And increase in the blood pressure, which leads to inhibition of renin release, is mainly contributed by activating high pressure baroreceptors, thereby reducing the renal sympathetic tone, and by increasing the pressure in preglomerular vessels, and by reducing NaCl reabsorption from the proximal tubule, which increases the tubular delivery of NaCl to macula densa. So these are the feedback regulations of renin. Coming to the drugs that affect the renin release. First of all, coming to drugs that stimulate renin release, the first one is loop diuretics. They decrease the arterial blood pressure and block reabsorption of NaCl at macula densa. And similarly, ACE inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers, they interrupt both short and long loop negative feedback mechanism and increase the renin release. So loop diuretics, ACE inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers, all of them, they increase the renin release. Now coming to drugs which inhibit the renin release. NSAIDs which inhibit prostaglandin synthesis, therefore they decrease the renin release, and similarly selective COX-2 inhibitors, they also decrease renin release, and beta blockers also reduce renin secretion and plasma renin activity. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe for further videos on pharmacology and other related pharmaceutical sciences.